Carlos Ghosn as its chairman. The giant of the car industry, Ghosn, was arrested after allegations of financial misconduct. Will the Renault-Nissan-Mitsubishi alliance endure? And a town of paradise devastated by deadliest wildfire in California's history. Northern campfire nearly contained. Death toll increases even as evacuees spend Thanksgiving in parking lots. Our top story this week is from Pakistan, where two Pakistani police officials were killed in an exchange of fire near the Chinese consulate in Karachi on Friday. Pakistani Prime Minister Imran Khan has ordered a complete inquiry into the attack. Three gunmen tried to break into the consulate building. All the attackers were killed in an exchange of gunfire with the security forces. An outlawed militant organization, the Balochistan Liberation Army, has claimed responsibility for the attack that opposes Chinese projects linked to its Belt and Road Initiative in resource-rich Balochistan. China has also strongly condemned the attack, adding that the attack will not negatively affect the construction of the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. Meanwhile, in another attack, a powerful bomb blast ripped through a busy market outside a religious seminary in Pakistan's restive Khyber Pakhtunkhwa province, killing at least 25 people and injuring over 35 others. Now, the two attacks are likely unconnected, but they underline the security challenges Pakistan faces, including those from separatists and the Pakistani Taliban based in the northern border regions. Meanwhile, India has also strongly condemned the terrorist attack on the Chinese consulate in Karachi. In a tweet, Ravish Kumar condoled the loss of lives and he wrote that there can be no justification whatsoever for any act of terrorism. All right, let's get more updates and perspective on that story we have with us. So Mr. Shashank, former Foreign Secretary, joining us. Thank you so much, Ambassador, for joining us on Rajya Sabha TV. So I would like to know from you, how do you look at this attack on the Chinese consulate in Karachi by the Balochistan Liberation Army, considering that this is not the first attack on Chinese by Baloch rebels? Yes, do you think that really exposes the risks and the fallouts of the Pakistan-China business relations?
Well, Pakistan-China relationship is supposed to be one of the strongest in the region. And Pakistan has been going all out to give as much space as possible, despite all kinds of discomfort within Pakistan, especially in Balochistan and Pakhtunkhwa. Provinces that their territories are being used for China-Pakistan economic corridor, but without any participation of the local people.
Yes.
Most of the contracts have gone on either to the Chinese or to the Punjabis. And therefore, there is a feeling that it is the ruling class in Pakistan which is strengthening its hold over the territories, including Balochistan. And so for a very long time, the Baloch people have been fighting for a greater say in the running of their very sparse province, but very, very rich in mineral resources. And it also provides that external connectivity via Gwadar to the Middle East. And therefore, those people feel that once the China-Pakistan corridor is built completely, they would be totally ruined and it will be total colonization of the Baloch land. They have generally been mounting protest marches in New York, in UK and in Switzerland, etc. And whenever international meetings take place. However, that has not had much of an impact. So they have started carrying out through this Balochistan Liberation Army these attacks on the Chinese and on the others to discourage them from coming into Pakistan. It's a different matter that Pakistan feels that it is the neighboring countries which have been encouraging these terror attacks in Pakistan. This has happened again and again. Whenever there are terror attacks on Pakistani assets, immediately the finger is pointed towards either Afghanistan or Iran or India. And India has repeatedly said that when it wants to attack Pakistan, it has carried out surgical strikes and has informed the world about it.
Absolutely.
It is the Pakistanis who have been mounting these attacks in the neighboring countries' territories, and that's how SAARC summit has not made much progress. because so many countries don't want to give Pakistan the chance to hold a summit when terrorists are running freely within the territory and also are being encouraged by the Pakistani establishment.
Absolutely. And you mentioned about the fact how the, you know, local people in Balochistan really have not been able to benefit really from the CPEC, all the construction, the infrastructure, the projects that are going on there. But there are also reports about the, you know, sinification of this area, the Balochistan area. There have been reports of Chinese influence, trying to influence the locals there. So do you think that issue, that simmering tension has also led to these circumstances?
No, there is no doubt that Pakistan government is encouraging its people to learn Chinese and to be more kind to the Chinese people, because they have already mounted more than 15 to 20,000 Pakistani troops to help the security of the Chinese nationals in Pakistan. But it's not going to be enough. Therefore, the Pakistan and China, they are both trying, firstly, to contact these terrorist organizations directly to influence them. So we do not know whether this will work out for Baloch National Liberation Army also or not. Mm-hmm. But what we know that with the other groups, whether it's Al-Qaeda, whether it's Taliban, whether they are the various organizations acting against India and elsewhere, the Chinese are trying to build direct contact with them so that at least the Chinese personnel in Pakistan are not harmed. And we know that the Pakistanis, all said and done, they call themselves the country meant for Islam.
Right.
And there are Islamic forces which are trying to take over Pakistan. Mm. And they know that China has become a prison house for many of the Muslim communities living in China. Mm-hmm. So that's the additional element, apart from what the Baloch nationalists are saying, that Pakistanis have been always killing them with impunity.
In general, in Pakistan, there have been voices, including, you know, the economists there, who are questioning the CPEC. They're questioning, they're saying that CPEC is only benefiting China. And they're also worrying about the repayment of loans. Those voices are also now going to, you know, speak up more after this attack that has happened.
Well, Pakistan calls itself a democracy, but it is not really a democracy. So there is not likely to be a change of Pakistani government policy towards their alliance with China, unlike what is happening in the other countries, which are more democratic than Pakistan, whether it's Malaysia, Indonesia, Sri Lanka, or Maldives, etc. There are voices which say that, look, Chinese are turning debt into equity and getting their lands and their assets at a very cheap price. Mm-hmm. But in Pakistan, these will remain isolated voices. Pakistan government is constantly mounting the campaign that these are the neighboring countries who are unhappy about the great progress which is being made in Pakistani infrastructure development with the Chinese help. And they are tom-tomming that they got $6 billion from Saudi Arabia. They got about a similar amount, though they kept it secret under the Chinese request. And now they are saying that they are likely to obtain a similar amount from the UAE. So therefore, they feel that, look, they don't care about IMF and world institutions and credibility of their performance. What they need is the strong support from countries like China, Saudi Arabia, and UAE, whether on Islamic cause or whether because they are providing the economic corridor to China.
Absolutely. So indeed, Pakistan thought that the CPEC would help improve the country's economy and infrastructure, boost economic growth in the country, but little did it know